Thank you. I send salam to all the participants at this conference. I also send special salams to His Eminence, the Pope, and Monsignor for this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to be here. I've sent in my paper to this conference, which is very long, and I'm not going to read it, so I jettisoned it. It contains data and graphs. I'm lucky to be speaking today after all the eloquent speakers from yesterday and immediately after my sister Helen Ogunwumeju, who is from Nigeria and has given you all the legal proceedings and procedures and enactments in place in Nigeria. The phenomenon of human trafficking is the same all over the world, so I can safely just adopt what was said by all the previous speakers from yesterday and today. However, I come from a region in Nigeria that is ravaged by what is known and called as the Boko Haram terrorists. I will share with you what is happening there and the new ways the organized crime is being perpetrated in this area. This area covers about 24 million people, and is an area of about 14% of population of Nigeria. It covers 6 states. It's a very large chunk. It's called the northeastern part of Nigeria. And it is classified by the United Nations as one of the poorest regions in Africa. The cities and villages in these areas have been destroyed completely by the terrorists in the ongoing fight, some completely wiped out. The government of Nigeria thus has now put up and set up a lot of places called the internally displaced people's camps, called the IDPs. The issue I want to bring to our attention is what is going on in these camps, where 52% of them are women, a place that is supposed to be a shelter for displaced persons. In the IDP camps, food is not very readily available. And when it is never enough. For children to be fed, women are asked for sex, and the young girls are offered for more food. This act of sextortion is perpetrated by both the more affluent members in the camp and the camp officials that are meant to safeguard the lives of the people. Young girls and married women are prostituted for favors. The ring is so elaborate within and outside the camps. As a result, many unwanted pregnancies, abortions, and STDs abound. The victims do not report, as even the officials are involved. Young girls are trafficked in form of being married out to curry favors for or a little more food and some clothing. Children born as a result of these activities are sold out. The syndicate is so organized. The second type of human trafficking I want to share with you today is called baby factory. This takes special types of forms. The first type is where a doctor or a matron establishes a clinic where young girls with unwanted pregnancies are referred to or lured to. They are looked after until they give birth, and the babies are sold out. Actually, in most cases, they are induced into labor because somebody who wants to buy the babies has been invited to come into the clinic that day. The second type is where the doctor or an elderly person sets up a home under the pretext of assisting these young girls with unwanted pregnancies that have been sent out of their homes. Once the child is born, it is sold out. And since the girl has nowhere to go, she's encouraged to stay at the home, where a young man is invited to impregnate her again and again and again, and the cycle continues. She becomes a baby factory, and her babies are harvested. There is always a ready market for these children, either out of the country or within. The children are either sold to couples who genuinely want children to adopt, or to ritualists for sacrifice. Because the organization of illicit business is so strong, only a few cases ever come to light. Upon discovery, the perpetrators are arraigned, and the properties stroke building are used for these activities are demolished by an act of government. It's completely demolished. The government has put in place all sorts of laws, as Justice Ogunwumiju has told us, in place, and has been said to by all the previous speakers, and in Nigeria, it is not different. The law can only come into play when the criminals are caught. Most victims do not report due to several reasons. For example, due to stigma, poverty, and fear, and the barons are always a step ahead of the law. Wars and poverty are a great contributory factor to human trafficking. I join His Eminence the Pope in calling for peace around the world. We must be our brothers' keepers and not our brothers' killers. In Nigeria, under the National Social Investment Program, established in the office of the Vice President, a program called Makaton, which is coined from Hackton and Making, is being introduced. It is a toll-free line that victims or witnesses can call into without necessarily disclosing their identity as a helpline and an avenue to report offenders. It simply asks questions like, do you want to discuss it? Do you want to meet with a counselor? Do you want to report to a community leader or to the police or to someone in your family? Do you need medical attention? Do you want us to help you with any of the above? The government still needs to do more and devise ways and intensify efforts to create jobs so that people can have a means of sustenance to reduce crime. The courts can only come into play to be proactive if there is a crime to try. Organized crime has no borders. It has no color, and it has no religion. We all need to be more sensitive to happenings around us. I wish to thank the Pontifical Academy of Sciences for organizing this wonderful conference, and thank the IAWJ for facilitating my participation of such a large contingent of women judges from around the world to share their experiences. I wish to thank His Eminence the Pope for being so gender sensitive to have approved such an outing. I pray that I meet with him in my lifetime. Thank you for listening to me.